Good morning, interweb. Let's world build. If we assume a solar neighborhood-like distribution of stars, an interstellar empire spanning a somewhat modest 250,000 cubic light-years will contain about 1,000 stars, which is a number large enough to be awe-inspiring but small enough to be dealt with in a single tutorial video, albeit a rather lengthy one. So strap yourselves in, today we're going to learn how to build 1,000 stars. So on average, 1,000 Milky Way stars contain 900 main sequence stars, 96 white dwarfs, and 4 giant stars, which is very cool. Cooler still is the fact that the main sequence is comprised of many different types of stars, O, B, A, F, G, K, and M stars, statistically broken down like so. This is known as the MK classification system, which orders stars by spectral type, high mass to low mass, remembered by the mnemonic, O be a fine Gungan, kiss me. Now if we apply these percentages to our 900 main sequence stars and round to one sig fig, the stellar ingredients of our little demo empire will be 1 O star, 1 B star, 5 A stars, 30 F stars, 70 G stars, 100 K stars, 700 M stars, 100 white dwarfs, and 4 giant stars. And although not represented in our little sample size, I'll chuck in a neutron star and a black hole just for good measure. Let's build. Main sequence stars are sun-like stars, happily undergoing hydrogen burning in their cores. They are inherently very stable, so we'll be able to say lots about them. First step when building any star is to set the mass. This is crucial. Main sequence stars have masses between 0.08 and 50 solar masses. Consider these hard limits. Within these limits, we have smaller mass ranges based on stellar type. Consider these softer limits. Decide what class of star you're going to build and choose an appropriate mass. Now, only stars between 0.5 and 1.4 solar masses are considered habitable. That is, habitable in the sense that carbon-based humanoid life forms could naturally evolve on planets orbiting these stars. Everything else isn't uninhabitable per se. Their planets could be locations for colonies, mining expeditions, and/or exile locations for little green lads with terrible syntax. If you've chosen a mass less than our sun, your star's radius will be given by, or the radius of your star in solar radii is equal to m, the mass of your star in solar masses, raised to the power of 0.8. If your star is more massive than our sun, use the formula or the radius of your star in solar radii is equal to m, the mass of your star in solar masses, raised to the power of 0.5. With the mass and radius defined, you can go ahead and calculate the circumference, surface area, volume, and density of your star. Pro tip, world builders hate constants. Pi, yuck, get rid of them. World builders deal in proportionality. It's much easier. So a star twice as large as our sun will have twice the circumference, 4 times the surface area and 8 times the volume, etc. Simple. The luminosity or intrinsic brightness of your star will be given by the mass-luminosity relationship. L, the luminosity of your star relative to the sun, is equal to m, the mass of your star in solar masses, raised to the power of 3.5. It's quite a good fit for the main sequence, but it's not perfect. We could be more accurate. For example, we could make order of magnitude estimations like so, but frankly, for our purposes, it's kind of overkill. Stick with this formula. The amount of time your star will spend on the main sequence will be given by t, time on the main sequence, is equal to your mass divided by your luminosity. Multiplying by a solar lifetime, 10 billion years, gives you your star's lifetime in Earth years. Interesting side note, the least massive stars will stay on the main sequence for about 6 trillion years, which is a long time. In fact, up to 400 times longer than time itself. The effective temperature, i.e. the surface temperature of your star, will be given by T, the temperature, is equal to the luminosity divided by the radius squared, all raised to the power of 1 over 4. Multiplying by the temperature of the sun, 5778 Kelvin, gives you your star's temperature in Kelvin. Then use this chart to gauge the colour of your star from a blue to a light orangey red. To be clear, when seen by humanoid life forms from the surface of a planet, all stars, regardless of spectral type, appear white. The colours on the chart are an attempt at defining true colours. Links in the doobly-doo for further reading and clarification, and yes, Photoshop users, those are hex values. If you intend to have life-supporting planets orbiting your stars, make sure those planets orbit in the habitable zone. The inner boundary of the habitable zone in AU is given by the square root of the luminosity divided by 1.1, and the outer boundary in AU is given by the square root of the luminosity divided by 0.53. Massive caveat, I'm defining habitability in terms of Earth-like life forms. Silicon-based lifeforms may require a totally different habitable zone, as would life using methane as a solvent, for example. But exobiology is a topic for another day. So with these few parameters defined, you can say with confidence that you've constructed a main sequence star worthy of its own Wikipedia page. Now all that's left to do is run the process another 899-ish times and move on to... Main sequence stars are like Shane from The Walking Dead, and post-main sequence stars are like, well, Shane from The Walking Dead. Living stars hang out in the main sequence, and everything else is either dead or dying. Dead or dying stars are, for the most part, extremely hard to describe using simple maths. So let's take a break from the formulas for a bit and check out some nifty graphs. By definition, giants have significantly larger radii and luminosities than main sequence stars of the same temperature. They're bigger, they're brighter, but they ain't hotter. Low to intermediate mass main sequence stars begin to evolve into giants when they start to run out of hydrogen fuel and leave the main sequence. Same goes for high mass main sequence stars, just they turn into supergiants instead. Supergiants are like regular giants, except on crack. They're even larger and even more luminous than regular giants, but again, they're very cool. TLDR, giants are the mature stage of stellar evolution. Anyways, this is the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram which plots the relationship between luminosity and temperature of stars. Here's the main sequence, and here's the giants. Simply pick something in the orange or blue region, and the appropriate data for luminosity, temperature, radius, and spectrotype will be generated for you. Which is a relief. I mean, look, this is a main sequence star of 1.2 solar masses. Watch what happens as it evolves off the main sequence. Simple formulas cannot account for this level of insanity, so use graphs to build your giants. Links in the doobly-doo. Let's talk habitability. We can calculate the habitable zone around a giant star just like we did for the main sequence stars. However, as a star expands and grows in luminosity, close-in planets will be swallowed up and its habitable zone will sweep outwards. So unlike main sequence stars, habitability around giant stars would change drastically with time. For the most part, no planet will remain in this migrant habitable zone long enough for life to arise naturally. But maybe we don't need life to arise. Maybe all we need is a suitable atmosphere to develop, thus making the planet colonizable. This scenario, though improbable, is somewhat plausible. Links in the doobly-doo. The defining properties of compact objects are mass and radius. That is to say, white dwarfs, neutron stars, and black holes are all extremely tiny, and for their size, extremely massive. So let's focus on mass and radius. White dwarfs have masses between 0.17 and 1.4 solar masses, neutron stars lie between 1.4 and 3 solar masses, and at about 5 solar masses, a compact object is likely a stellar mass black hole. Supermassive black holes, like those found in the center of most galaxies, range from hundreds of thousands to several tens of billions of solar masses. So that's mass. What about radius? Counterintuitively, the more massive a white dwarf is, the smaller it is. We can ballpark the radius of a white dwarf using the formula R, the radius of your white dwarf in Earth radii, is equal to m, the mass of your white dwarf in solar masses, raised to the power of negative 1 over 3. So a white dwarf of 1.4 solar masses will be about 90% the size of Earth, which looks like this. Neutron stars, on the other hand, will be confined to radii of about 10 to 13 kilometers. Yeah, you heard right, kilometers. Now, the size of black holes are determined by their event horizon, or Schwarzschild radius, which is given, in kilometers, by 2.95 times the mass of your black hole in solar masses. So a 5 solar mass black hole will have an event horizon at about 15 kilometers. 1.5 times this distance gives us the photon sphere, which in effect is the lower bound for any stable orbit. In terms of habitability, none of these objects are particularly habitable. Toxic levels of radiation, inward migrating habitable zones, extreme tidal forces, etc. are all pretty life hostile. But I'll leave you with this really, really speculative idea. Let's say an icy super-Earth was ejected into interstellar space. Let's say it passed by a stellar mass black hole on a trajectory tangential to the black hole's photon sphere and was captured. Now, black holes emit almost no heat. Hawking radiation is negligible, but let's say our planet slipped into an orbit such that the tidal forces it experienced were enough to heat and thaw its interior, but not enough to tear it apart. The planet's interior would melt and we'd be left with a subsurface liquid ocean, and life may evolve around thermal vents deep within this ocean. Now, it's not probable. In fact, it's probably impossible. But hey, speculation courses through every world builder's veins. Good morning, interwebs. So long-time viewers of Artifexium will be very familiar with the video you just watched. It's basically a remake of one of the very first videos I made on Artifexing. Now, I'm not going to start going back and remaking every single old Artifexing video, it's just that that particular video really bugged me. For various reasons, it really needed to be updated, so consider this the update. Next time, the good ship Artifexing is back on track. As always, click the links on screen or in the description for more Artifexing content. Like, and if you think I earned it, hit the subscribe button. Thank you all so much for watching. Edgar out.